The Vietnam War, with its relentless brutality, exposed a weakness in America's military machine that could no longer be ignored. The venerable C-130 Hercules, once the backbone of U.S. tactical airlift, was faltering under the demands of remote, unforgiving combat zones where short, rough airstrips turned every landing into a gamble. The need for a new breed of airlifter, one that could conquer the harshest conditions, land in spaces no larger than a football field, and bear the heaviest military hardware, became undeniable. Out of this dire necessity, the blueprints for the Boeing YC-14 were forged, an aircraft so revolutionary it seemed to defy the laws of physics. While the C-130 needed over 4,000 feet of runway to take off, the YC-14 could soar over a 50-foot obstacle with just 2,000 feet and a jaw-dropping 27,000-pound payload. It harnessed the Coandă effect, manipulating exhaust flow to generate extraordinary lift, allowing it to land in just 387 feet at a mere 99 miles per hour, an achievement that no other airlifter had ever approached. But the YC-14 was more than just a short field marvel. It could transport a 109,000-pound M60A2 main battle tank across continents, and with a climb rate of 6,000 feet per minute, it ascended three times faster than the C-130, promising to redefine battlefield logistics and survivability. The YC-14 was poised to become the ultimate military logistics machine, meeting and exceeding nearly every demand the Air Force had set. Its potential to reshape the face of warfare was undeniable. So undeniable, in fact, that even the Soviets took notice. Rumors swirled that Soviet agents had stolen the YC-14's design, a bold move to create their own weapon to challenge American air supremacy. Yet, just as the YC-14 was acing every test and primed to take over the military airlift command, it vanished. The Vietnam War exposed critical limitations in the United States Air Force's tactical airlift capabilities. While reliable, the workhorse of the era, the Lockheed C-130 Hercules, struggled with the demanding conditions of Southeast Asian combat zones. Still, it was this fleet of cargo planes that made the entire war effort possible. As one USAF report at the time noted, quote, "Let's be blunt, it was the ability of the USAF transport fleet, running their seemingly steady and boring flight routes all across South Vietnam, supplying both U.S. and Allied forces with all of the minutiae that makes war possible, that allowed the conflict to be fought." However, the need for an aircraft capable of operating from shorter, rougher airstrips while carrying heavier payloads became increasingly apparent. This realization led to the inception of the Advanced Medium STOL Transport, or AMST, program in 1972. The new aircraft needed to transport a 27,000-pound payload over 500 nautical miles without refueling, all while taking off and landing on a mere 2,000-foot runway. Boeing, with its rich history of innovation, rose to the challenge. The company's engineers turned to a concept that had been studied by NASA but never applied to a production aircraft: upper surface blowing. This revolutionary approach involved mounting the engines above the wing, allowing their exhaust to flow over its upper surface and trailing edge flaps. When the flaps were deployed, the Coandă effect would come into play, bending the exhaust downward and dramatically increasing lift. The decision to pursue USB was not taken lightly, as John K. Wimpress, a key figure in the YC-14's development, recounted after visiting NASA Langley, quote, "Joe Johnson and Dudley Hammond both reported on testing and showed Wimpress data that verified the high lift performance that Boeing had quoted in its proposal. This validation from NASA gave Boeing the confidence to proceed with its bold design." The YC-14 project represented more than just a new aircraft. It was a paradigm shift in military transport design. By leveraging cutting-edge aerodynamic principles and pushing the boundaries of engine placement, Boeing aimed to create an aircraft that could revolutionize tactical airlift operations. The stage was set for one of the most innovative aircraft in USAF history. The Boeing YC-14 was a marvel of aeronautical engineering, incorporating several groundbreaking design features that set it apart from conventional transport aircraft. The upper surface blowing concept was at the heart of its revolutionary design, which fundamentally altered the relationship between the engines and the wing. two General Electric CF650D turbofans, each capable of producing an impressive 51,000 pounds of thrust, were mounted high on the aircraft's shoulder. Complementing the USB system was a supercritical wing design pioneered by NASA's Richard Whitcomb. This advanced airfoil shape allowed for efficient high-speed cruise while providing excellent low-speed characteristics crucial for STOL operations. The combination of USB and the supercritical wing gave the YC-14 its remarkable short-field performance. The YC-14's flight deck was equally innovative. Boeing introduced one of the first digital flight information readouts in military transport, presaging the glass cockpits that would become standard in later decades. This advanced avionics suite provided pilots with unprecedented levels of information and control. These innovations translated into extraordinary performance metrics. The YC-14 could take off in as little as 800 feet under optimal conditions, a fraction of the 3,500 feet required by the C-130 Hercules for a similar payload. Even more impressive was its landing performance, with one test recording a landing roll of just 387 feet. The aircraft's cargo hold was designed to accommodate outsized military equipment, including the ability to carry an M60A2 battle tank weighing 109,000 pounds. This capability significantly exceeded the original AMST requirements and demonstrated the YC-14's potential to revolutionize military logistics. With its unique engine placement, advanced wing design, and cutting-edge avionics, the YC-14 represented a quantum leap in transport aircraft technology. It promised to redefine the possibilities of tactical airlift, offering a level of versatility and performance that was unmatched in its class. The YC-14's journey from drawing board to sky began in earnest on August 9, 1976, when the first prototype, serial number 72-1873, took flight. This achievement kickstarted a rigorous series of flight evaluations at Edwards Air Force Base. The comprehensive testing regimen aimed to explore the aircraft's full capabilities and verify the bold performance assertions made by Boeing. Throughout the testing phase, the YC-14 consistently demonstrated nothing short of remarkable performance. The aircraft's ability to operate at extremely low speeds was particularly impressive. Test pilots successfully flew the YC-14 at speeds as low as 59 knots, a feat that showcased the effectiveness of its upper surface blowing system in generating lift at near stall conditions. At the other end of the performance spectrum, the YC-14 proved equally capable. It achieved a maximum speed of Mach 0.78 at 38,000 feet, demonstrating its potential for efficient high-altitude cruise. Perhaps most impressive was the aircraft's climb rate. The YC-14 could ascend at 6,000 feet per minute, more than triple the rate of the C-130 Hercules it was designed to replace. One of the most dramatic demonstrations of the YC-14's capabilities came when it successfully loaded and unloaded an M60A2 battle tank weighing 109,000 pounds, far exceeding its design specifications. This feat, which its competitor, the McDonnell Douglas YC-15, did not attempt, underscored the YC-14's potential to revolutionize military logistics. The YC-14 was then tested in some of the plant's most challenging environments, such as the Alaskan wilderness. These tests were crucial in evaluating the aircraft's cold weather performance and its ability to operate in remote, rugged areas. However, the testing phase also revealed some significant flaws in the ambitious design. Engineers discovered that the YC-14's drag was 11% higher than initially predicted. In response, Boeing implemented several modifications, including the addition of vortex generators to the upper aft portion of the nacelles and alterations to the landing gear pods. These changes reduced the drag increment to 7%, demonstrating the team's ability to rapidly iterate and improve the design. By the conclusion of flight testing in late summer 1977, the YC-14 had convincingly proven its worth. It had met or exceeded nearly all of the Air Force's demanding requirements, showcasing unparalleled STOL performance and versatility. The YC-14 was seemingly poised to usher in a new era of military transport aviation. Despite the YC-14's impressive performance and promising potential, fate had a very different hand to play for the promising warplane. The conclusion of U.S. involvement in Vietnam in 1973 and the oil crisis that followed dramatically altered the landscape in which the AMST program operated. As early as March 1976, signs of a changing tide emerged. General David C. Jones, the Air Force Chief of Staff, initiated studies to explore the possibility of using a single aircraft model for both tactical and strategic airlift roles. This marked a significant departure from the original AMST concept, which was primarily focused on tactical operations. The end of the Vietnam War profoundly impacted the USAF's transport needs. As one report noted, quote, "The Vietnam War had fueled a huge market for contract air transport services that had massively supplemented the USAF's own capabilities. But the end of US involvement in Southeast Asia and the massive oil crisis post the 1973 Yom Kippur War meant that these private companies had seen their contracts end, and as a result, the divestment of much of their air transport fleets. This shift left the USAF with a critical gap in its strategic airlift capabilities. The aging C-141 Starlifter fleet, which had seen heavier usage than anticipated, needed substantial life extension programs. Consequently, the Air Force's focus pivoted from tactical to strategic transport needs. In December 1979, the AMST program was officially terminated. The decision came not because of any shortcomings in the YC-14's performance, but due to its misalignment with the Air Force's evolving strategic vision. The cancellation of the AMST program led to the formation of the CX Task Force in November 1979. This new initiative aimed to develop an aircraft that could bridge the gap between tactical and strategic airlift capabilities. Ironically, this requirement closely mirrored General Jones's earlier inquiries about a dual-role aircraft. The YC-14, despite its technical achievements, had become a victim of changing times and shifting priorities. Its cancellation marked the end of an era in tactical transport design and the beginning of a new chapter in strategic airlift development. Although the Boeing YC-14 never entered production, its impact on aviation design and technology resonates decades after its cancellation. The aircraft's innovative features and performance capabilities left an indelible mark on the field of military transport aviation. Perhaps the most direct legacy of the YC-14 can be seen in the development of the C-17 Globemaster III. While the C-17 was based more closely on the YC-15, it incorporated several lessons from the YC-14 program, particularly regarding short field performance and advanced avionics. The C-17's takeoff capabilities on rough airfields while carrying substantial payloads are a testament to the groundwork laid by the AMST program and the YC-14. Internationally, the influence of the YC-14 is most evident in the Soviet Antonov An-72. As one source notes, quote, "Given the similarities of the design with its overwing engine design, this has understandably led to allegations that the AN-72, which received the NATO designation of Kohler, was a product of Soviet espionage." While these claims remain unsubstantiated, the AN-72's design clearly echoes the YC-14's innovative engine placement, suggesting that Boeing's concept had a global impact. The YC-14's legacy extends beyond specific aircraft designs. Its use of upper surface blowing and supercritical wing technology pushed the boundaries of aerospace engineering, inspiring further research and development in these areas. The digital flight information system, pioneered in the YC-14's cockpit, was a precursor to the glass cockpits that are now standard in both military and civilian aircraft. One can only speculate on how military aviation might have evolved had the YC-14 entered service. Its unparalleled STOL capabilities could have revolutionized tactical airlift operations, potentially altering the conduct of military logistics and even influencing strategic planning. Today, the two YC-14 prototypes stand as silent testaments to what might have been. One rests at the Pima Air and Space Museum in Arizona, while the other is preserved at the USAF's Davis Monthan Boneyard. These aircraft serve as reminders of an era of bold innovation in military aviation, when the boundaries of what was possible were pushed to their limits. The YC-14 may not have achieved operational status, but its legacy lives on in its pioneered technologies and the boundaries it pushed. It remains a symbol of American aerospace ingenuity and a pivotal chapter in the ongoing quest for more capable and versatile military transport aircraft.